Good morning. It's a pleasure, a privilege to be here in Brisbane. I don't really have a formal speech to make. I have 20 minutes. I have some notes scribbled from while I was traveling from Dili to Canberra, and haven't had time to review it for today. Having reviewed the theme of this conference, I thought that it would be quite probably of interest to you, fitting to share with you my experience of the last 3 years working with the United Nations after I left the office. But before that, probably you understood from the introduction that I have had 40 years or more of association with the United Nations. First, as a representative of a forgotten people, forgotten national liberation movement, arriving in New York in the winter of December 75, having never been to New York and never really read much about the UN itself. So my association began as a representative of a forgotten people with very, very little influence, power behind us, behind me. And this went on for 24 years. Then became foreign minister. So from a freedom fighter, as we are described, in a more positive manner, because in the past, some of us would be described in not very kind ways by some of the Western media or Western academia, or particularly by confidential reports compiled by the State Department or the Department of Foreign Affairs, etc., in Canberra. You know, I was always sometimes practicing, sometimes non-practicing Catholic. And yet I was described as a hardline Marxist. My colleagues in Timor-Leste would laugh when they heard I was described as a Marxist. Really, he is a Marxist? Since when? And then became foreign minister, and before that, obviously, the Nobel Peace Prize. And then we had a crisis in 2006. I was asked to step in, first as defense minister. I declined, and I thought of some friends of mine, particularly former president of Costa Rica, Oscar Arias, good friend of mine, who always told me that Timor-Leste should not have an army after independence. And can you imagine Oscar Arias hearing that not only we have an army, but I became defense minister. So I thought, but our defense people insisted that they trust me, I should be defense minister. So I became defense minister, and soon after, prime minister as well. And then became president. So relationship with the UN, as foreign minister, as president. When I finished my term in 2012, the Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, very kindly asked me whether I would accept to be his special representative in Guinea-Bissau, in West Africa, which I did for a year and a half, to help the people there get rid of a coup, the military who staged a coup, won many, many times, they did over 40 years, to restore constitutional order. Sounds simple, but it's not that ever so simple. You have many vested interests there, rivalries of the countries of the region and beyond the region, as it happened elsewhere on the African continent, in Asia, and even in Latin America in the worst years of the violence, particularly in Central America. And if you look at the conflict in Congo, it's not only the problems of the Congolese, it's not only the failure of the UN. So, you know, some countries are fortunate to have great neighbors, who help you resolve your others, they strive in the tensions, the conflicts in your country. South Sudan is the same. Guinea-Bissau never was as bad as South Sudan, far from it, but it was extraordinarily complex with different conflicting interests, countries in the region and beyond. Apparently, I did a decent mission, and I ended, and then Secretary General asked me to serve as chair of what is called high-level panel on high-level independent panel on UN peace operations, and that is to review all the UN peace operations around the world and make recommendations to him, to the Security Council, General Assembly, on how to improve. So that's what I think would be fitting to talk to you today about it. A new Secretary General has just been elected unanimously, enthusiastic endorsement by the Security Council, and acclamation by the General Assembly. And he is Antonio Guterres, formerly High Commissioner for Human Rights. He did an outstanding job as High Commissioner for Human Rights. When he was running for the job of High Commissioner for Human Rights, I was asked to help influencing the decision in New York. And I sent a note to whoever were to make the decision among six or seven candidates for High Commissioner for Human Rights. And I told whoever the power that be in New York that would make the decision, do not look only at academic and professional background, because usually people who apply for this kind of jobs, whether it's for Secretary of the UN or for High Commissioner for Refugees, are people with outstanding academic and professional profile. Some even have 30 years of bureaucratic life. If you grew up in the United Nations system, from when you leave, you get your first bachelor's degree, and you end up being Under Secretary General, well, you are an accomplished UN bureaucrat, but you might not have had much exposure and experience in dealing with daily life, real challenges in a country, in building a nation, in managing expectations, and resolving conflicts in multi-ethnic, multicultural, divided societies. So I told whoever was to make the decision, please look also at the heart of the person, because for the High Commissioner of Refugees, you need a person with compassion, with a heart. And the choice fell on Antonio Guterres for High Commissioner for Refugees. If any of you had read two articles I wrote recently, if you haven't, you should. You click in Huffington Post, my name, /, Antonio Guterres, a few weeks before the decision of Security Council, and then a week before, I did another one. I had to do another one before the final decision, because while there seemed to be universal consensus that Antonio Guterres were the best qualified among those who had signed up, offered themselves to be Secretary General, suddenly, out of the blue, Angela Merkel, Germany, President Juncker of the European Commission, and the Bulgarian government decide to pull out of the hat a surprise candidate, Georgieva, Vice President of the European Commission. When there had been months of a transparent process, the first time ever in the history of the UN when candidates faced the public, like to some extent in the US Congress, anyone for senior position has to go through Senate hearings and then the confirmation process. So I was part of a group of the President of the General Assembly that discussed how to make the process more transparent. So public hearings were held, and Antonio Guterres shown among every other person. So it was, to our dismay, some people in the state system still wanted to short-circuit that and pull out another candidate. So that's why I wrote a second article. And again, 10 years after that first intervention to assist Antonio Guterres, to assist actually the High Commission for the UN to get the best person for the job, again, I use the same argument. At this time, 21st century of extraordinarily complex security, social challenges that we face, and that's why the Secretary General asked me and a group of people, including one gentleman from Queensland, Andrew Hill, a former very senior police officer. He was part of my team, but then he was forced to pull out because he had serious health issues, and I know he has recovered completely and better than before he was sick. So, and then one other person pulled out because he was promoted to a senior job in Brookings Institute in Washington. So we end up 15 people from across the globe with different backgrounds and to review the state of United Nations operations around the world, precisely because the previous report, which called the Brahimi Report of 15 years ago, did not anticipate, or at the time there were not the challenges that exist today, like implosion of states, like South Sudan, or Central African Republic, Mali. And the United Nations is called upon increasingly to address security crises around the world with 70% of its peacekeepers on the African continent. And with increasing challenges of its credibility and its effectiveness, one scandal after another, either because of behavior of some peacekeepers, like in Central African Republic, or failure of the peacekeepers who are deployed in protecting civilian population, even when they are on the ground, as you probably recall, the tragedy of Rwanda with the UN peacekeepers there, a genocide occurred. So in view of all of these and the growing complexity of the challenges, the EU Secretary General asked us to advise, to recommend on how to improve United Nations mechanisms in preventing conflicts, in resolving conflicts when they have occurred, and on how better to deploy troops faster, more professionally trained, with more equipment, that consistent with the complex mandate they give to the peacekeepers. One thing is known in the UN system is Christmas tree resolutions. Christmas tree because you have different constituents lobbying their respective governments to influence the drafting of a mission of a resolution. And everybody is satisfied because they have their issue on this Security Council resolution on a particular mission. That's called Christmas tree. When I was in Guinea-Bissau, I had two Security Council resolutions running many, many pages long. I ignore most of them because I said, no, I'm sent here to return the country to constitutional order. I will help the people here to fulfill what they want and this particular goal, and that to return the constitutional order. Everything else has to happen after a legitimate government has taken office. I refuse to be bogged down on by the weight of that Christmas tree. I stayed focused on what was the most important. Learning from our experience in Timor-Leste with the United Nations, important, effective, but not always most effective. You have the crisis in Syria. We have ongoing in Mali, not to mention Iraq, not to mention Libya. Afghanistan is still ongoing. We have the refugee crisis of millions of people fleeing either poverty or conflict in the Middle East, going to Europe, overwhelming Europe at a time when Europe become, we could say, without offense to my European friends, leaderless. With the British decided one way to fix the problems of the European Union is to quit the European Union. And now they don't know what to do with Brexit. Maybe go slow, maybe reverse. And then you have in Germany, a country that has under Angela Merkel, a pragmatic, maybe generous policy in accommodating the millions of refugees fleeing poverty and the extremism in the Middle East. Well, she's been punished by parts of the electorate, suffering some of the worst defeats in her own electorate, etc. And who will come up replacing Angela Merkel? And who will be coming up replacing the French socialist-led government of François Hollande? And there are already changes in Europe, in Austria, not to mention Hungary, etc. So we are facing with extraordinary dangerous situations, compounded by never-ending economic and financial crisis that began in 2008, 2009, at the end of George W. Bush's regime, with President Obama taking office in January 2009. 8 years later, the U.S. is doing reasonably well economically, probably the only OECD country that can say fully recover, but not the rest of the world. Consequence of this economic financial crisis, consequence of the refugee crisis, the crisis in South Sudan, ongoing in Congo, Mali, and elsewhere, all OECD countries, with the exception of the United Kingdom, reduce draconianly the ODA, Overseas Development Assistance. When I was in New York 2009, the fall 2009, as president, participating in the UN General Assembly, every OECD country promised that ODA would not be sacrificed by the economic financial crisis. Almost everyone has failed in that. Norway has maintained, Sweden, and the UK, I bow to them, the only G7 country in the midst of the economic financial crisis in Europe and in the UK, under a conservative government, David Cameron, who unfortunately is no longer there, actually increased ODA to 0.7%, a percentage that was recommended by the UN 20, 30 years ago, as a minimum to be able to really meet the needs of the developing world, and assuming the ODA is a well target. But the ODA basically has been obliterated around the world. Hardly any country is providing assistance through the multilateral system, through UN programs. UN is overstretched. As a result of that, we will see we are seeing increased poverty, instability in many parts of the world. So all these problems happening right now. And what is the role of the Secretary General of the UN? Can Antonio Guterres, the new Secretary General, fix the problem of Syria when the president of the greatest power of the world, Barack Obama, has not been able to? Can Antonio Guterres deliver freedom, independence, finally a resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Freedom, dignity, independence for the Palestinians after 60, 70 years. I was surprised in fall of 2009, being in New York, attending the UN General Assembly, with a blunt statement by Barack Obama saying, in a year from now, we will be celebrating Palestinian independence. Well, 8 years later, he can declare himself a failure in dealing with the Palestinian issue. Will Antonio Guterres be able to do that? My point is, A, every time there is a failure in addressing an international conflict, the UN is to blame. The Security Council is to blame. Well, the UN is made up of countries. It is not an abstract body. The Secretary General can do that much as long as there is political will on the part of the powers that be to address the challenges that we all face. The failure of Syria in Syria is the failure of President Obama, the failure of Putin, and the other major world leaders. But even if, and I believe President Obama probably agonized over it, he's an absolutely, unquestionably good man with integrity, with decency, and brilliance. Well, even he, leader of a superpower with a 7th, 6th fleet, the largest economy of the world, could not impact positively on Syria. How can we expect the Secretary General of the UN to do it? If we will not do it, blame him for the failure. So the UN often becomes the scapegoat of the failures of world leaders. However, a Secretary General who is brilliant, yes, he or she, in this case, is a he, Antonio Guterres, because of his personality, his humility, his simplicity, his patience, might be able to bring the parties together and address the conflict in Syria and in South Sudan, in Congo, and in Palestine. However, it's not only the responsibility of external actors. When you look at the situation in Syria and elsewhere, like in my own country, sometimes conflicts are of our own making. Leaders, whether they're elected or not elected, whether community leaders, confessional leaders, we have a primary responsibility for preventing conflicts, resolving conflicts when they occur, preventing conflicts from spiraling into open warfare. When I did this report, traveling throughout the world, listening to governments, peacekeepers, civil society, academics, we received 80 outstanding written contributions. We read through all of them. We had hundreds of hours of listening throughout the world. I always said, the UN may contribute 10 to 30% at most in solving a conflict. In the end, at the end of the day, it will be us, people concerned in our respective countries, are the ones who have to live up to our responsibilities. The UN can only assist, be able to assist those who want peace, who want to put violence in the past. However, the Secretary General can influence even those in the countries concerned who are not willing to live up to their responsibility to their own people in ensuring safety and tranquility. I'm conscious of the time. I have only 2 or 3 minutes more. I will end here by saying, the case of Timor-Leste, a small country, back then 1975, was often described as an impossible dream. Only naive people like me and many others could have thought that such a little country, in the face of the adversary and the adversary's friends in the region, and the adversary friends included Australia and the United States and many others, We were completely alone in the world as far as government is concerned, with some notable exceptions. Portugal, former colonial power, with extraordinary integrity, dignity, stood by us, living up to their historical responsibilities. And the former Portuguese-speaking country in Africa, Brazil, etc. Not many more. Friends were people like you, civil society, individuals in Australia and around the world. And as the world changed, technology changed, the world became smaller. By the 90s, people began to know about Timor-Leste. Today, dramatic difference of compared with the past, in the sense that something that happened today in a remote village through your iPhone, I don't use iPhone, I use Samsung, not Samsung 7, I use I use 6, which is still very good. And part in loyalty to my Korean friends, in part because I was working for Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, it was good to always show that I'm using Samsung. So I'm joking. So anyone can breach the walls of silence some people try to erect on issues. Diplomacy, the influence to shape policies, no longer prerogatives of unimaginative bureaucrats, whether from the UN or from governments. And we were helped in great part by individuals like you around the world, and including in Indonesia. We are free today because Indonesians also freed themselves in 1998-99 when students went to the street and brought down their imperial dictator, General Suharto. Then negotiations began, were accelerated. The new Indonesia agreed that it was a mistake what they did in 75, pull out. We, on our side, decide to put the past behind, in spite of the tragedy that we all endured for 24 years, thousands of lives lost. Many still carry in their bodies the signs of torture and the still deeper scar of the soul. But they all applauded, listened to the wisdom of the leaders and say, put the past behind. And today, Timor-Leste, small Catholic country, 98% Catholic, Indonesia with the largest Muslim population in the world, these two countries, once locked in a bitter conflict, today are the best of friends. We walk halfway towards Indonesia, and the Indonesians turn around and walk to meet us halfway. There is no better example of reconciliation than Timor-Leste and Indonesia. And we are setting up a center in Timor-Leste called International Center for Dialogue and Reconciliation, a joint center, Indonesia and Timor-Leste, to share our respective experiences, our joint experiences with the rest of the world on how countries lock in conflict, communities lock in conflict, with courage, with dignity, able to put behind, regardless of our history, regardless of our religions or faith. So there is hope in spite of the exceptional, extraordinary challenges that we face today. And a point to you for those probably from Australia who might be more familiar. We have had some frictions with Australia. Australia is a great country, one of our best friends in providing all kinds of assistance to Timor-Leste. But we have had frictions over the maritime boundary. Australia, being the larger country, they thought in the past, at least, that they should have the greater share of the Timor Sea, that we should be reduced to few meters offshore. Well, you know, from the logic of a big country, I think it seems to make sense. You know, but the Australian side then was shocked that we said we wouldn't agree with that. So we had these frictions for a while. Then we resort to a new mechanism under the law of the sea, UNCLOS, called compulsory conciliation, and Australia accepted to be part of it, appointed its own commissioners for the conciliation, and I'm not involved in it. I can only say, from the words of Xanana Guzmão, our national leader, and our Prime Minister, Dr. Rui Araújo, that the atmosphere and substance of the work that's been going on since The Hague in Singapore going well, positively. So we hope that with wisdom, with patience, Australia will again show its solidarity to Timor-Leste, as it did in 99, and as it has shown all these 15 years of tremendous technical, vocational, financial economic support to Timor-Leste, that finally agree to an equidistant line and that we can have a better arrangement in regard to the Timor Sea. I commend the Australian side for having accepted the UNCLOS mechanism, and I commend the two sides, my colleagues on the Timor side and the Australian side, for having shown once again how what is possible in spite of our frictions and differences. I thank you for the patience in listening to me, wish you success in this conference, and God bless you all and your esteemed, beloved families and friends. Thank you.